All right. We are tonight going into the genre of law. I'll start off with a cartoon. Here the guy says, I hate being confined by this fence. I'm jumping over it. And the fence is God's commands. And his friend says, wait, it's not a fence. It's a guardrail. And the guy falls over the cliff. Whoever keeps commandments keeps their life. But whoever shows contempt for their ways will die. This is a good illustration of the law. The law was given for our good. It was not given to restrict us, to keep us from being happy, to restrict our freedom, but it was given for our own good. Let's first of all look at the nature of the law. The law is an integral part of the covenant that God made with the people of Israel at Sinai. The arrangement of the Old Testament covenants follows the form of the suzerain vassal treaties of the Old Testament period. The suzerain vassal relationship was secured by agreements that were written, but these were not bilateral. And neither are the idea of the Old Testament, the treaties, the covenants of the Old Testament. It's a vertical arrangement. Conditions are set by the superior, and the inferior agrees to abide by them and obey the conditions. In the Old Testament, the covenant isn't between equals. God didn't negotiate with the Israelites and come up with a mutually agreed upon contract with stipulations binding on both parties so that either party could nullify it. Rather, God gave the children of Israel a covenant, and all they could do was to keep it, accept it, or reject it, keep it or break it. And since God made it, only he could nullify it or change it. The Old Testament law was God's gracious provision for Israel. By it, he entered into a covenant relationship with them, offering them his covenant love and rich blessings. They, in turn, were to keep the provisions of the covenant. This was God's way of dealing with the people in the Old Testament. We should not think of the law as being a law code in the modern sense of the term. It was not a comprehensive code that considered every possible infraction and gave specific sentences. It rather gave illustrative situations, sample cases from which the people of Israel could make inferences to apply to similar cases. Loyalty and obedience are the principal requirements of the God who chose to make covenants with his people. The God of the Old Testament was different from the gods of the surrounding nations. The polytheistic deities were capricious. They acted arbitrarily without regard to values. By capricious, we mean, they could change their mind at any time. You didn't know. They were larger than life with larger than life human frailties. The kings of the Old Testament period were absolute despots, much like the gods whom they served. By despots, we mean tyrants. What they said goes. Their word is the law. The Old Testament law introduces a new kind of God. First of all, He is the only God, but he is also perfect. The idea of monotheism revealed to Moses is linked to holiness, justice, love, and grace. God is a personal being who moves in compassion toward his people. In the record of the Old Testament, God does not change. It is his people who break covenant. God's judgments come because they are required by his nature, but he always brings judgment tinged with heartbreak. The Old Testament is not our covenant. Only those demands of the Old Testament, which are explicitly repeated in the New Testament, are binding on Christians. Now, we're going to look at three different ways of looking at this. And this position is the position of Fee and Stewart. But if we choose not to understand the Old Testament law, we will not understand fully what God has done for us in sending Jesus. All the Old Testament law is still the word of God to us, even though it is not the command of God to us. The Old Testament, the laws of the Old Testament are expressed in two ways. The first is casuistic, or we could call this case study. The violation and the punishment are stipulated. It often uses if-then construction. An example would be Exodus 21, 7 through 11. If a man sells his daughter as a servant, she is not to go free as male servants do. And notice the ifs here. If she does not please the master who has selected her for himself, he must let her be redeemed. He has no right to sell her to foreigners because he has broken faith with her. If he selects her for his son, he must grant her the rights of a daughter. If he marries another woman, he must not deprive the first one of her food, clothing, and marital rights. If he does not provide her with these three things, she is to go free without any payment of money. So it's an if, then. Now in the English construction here, we don't have the thens. But in this first line, it could say, if a man sells his daughter as a servant, then she is not to go free as male servants do. So it gives a condition and then the response. So this is casuistic. You get the violation and you get the punishment for it or the guidance for it. Secondly, we have apodictic, and this is a direct imperative or prohibition. Apodictic law gives general principles of right or wrong with no specific penalties stipulated. An example of this would be the Ten Commandments. So they give broad principles with no exceptions. Very often, apodictic laws are negative. Thou shalt not. Now, one subtype of this is called lex talionis. The punishment fits the crime. For example, Exodus 21, 23 to 25. But if there is serious injury, you are to take life for life, eye for eye, tooth for tooth, hand for hand, foot for foot, burn for burn, wound for wound, bruise for bruise. Now we need to understand the principle the law was teaching to those who first received it, and recognize that the principle is still valid, then we should apply it to our own time and culture. Now let's look at historical approaches to the law. For Luther, the first use of the law is the law is a guardian from Galatians 3:24. Paedagogos is the Greek word here. And this was a person who trains the child by bringing him to school. The law is designed to get us to the place where we can learn something. When we look at the law, we see our sinfulness. Luther called it the right hand of God, or the hammer that smashes. So the law was like a guardian until the time that Christ came. This guardian was not a well-respected person normally. He was a slave and was not thought of very well normally in the Greco-Roman culture. The second use of the law from Galatians 3:19, mankind left without restraint would self-destruct. Thus the law acts as a lid on evil, keeping it limited for the preservation of society. The civil use of the law then is number two. Ethical principles about human behavior that are captured, for example, in the Ten Commandments. Commandments 1-4 are principles of relationships of creatures to creator. Commandments 5-10 are principles about relationships with one another or between creatures. Now, Calvin used Luther's first two uses of the law and added one. The third use of the law is didactic. The law teaches us. Now, Reconstructionists say that it's God's purpose that Christians should take over the world and enforce the Old Testament law as civil law on all nations. Maybe you've heard of Reconstructionists. Okay, what about the Christian and the law? Let me just ask you first if you have any questions here.
Questions? Which law is the, as you described, define the first one, which, well, as you mentioned, the second one is more like the Ten Commandments.
Yes, yes.
The first law, which...
The casuistic.
Yes, yes. Which part of the Ten Commandments that law fits in?
It doesn't. The Ten Commandments are the apodictic.
So what you're saying is that the Ten Commandments is the apodictic.
That's right.
The first one, how can we describe that it's part of the Ten Commandments? Or just a law by Moses?
Okay. The Ten Commandments are what we call apodictic. That is, there is no punishment listed for violating. You shall have no other God before me. Okay, well, what happens if you don't have, if you do have other gods before God? It doesn't say. It just lays down the general principle. You should not worship a graven image. Well, what happens if you do? Well, that law doesn't say. You see, so it's general. It doesn't list a punishment. It just tells you what you ought to do. The casuistic gives you a violation and what happens if you violate. If this, then that. So as you look at the law, you see both kinds. The Ten Commandments are examples of apodictic. And I gave one example here of a casuistic. Okay?
And the point that the thing that struggles me now is because they put it this way and make it is the Ten Commandments. It's what we, it's what I understand. It's from God, right?
That's right.
Is it? So yeah. If I can ask a question now, which part of that Ten Commandments that the second as casuistic, whatever you call it, it fits in? Because it, now it's more like it's too sort of, well, that's the way I look at it now. It's more like it's two sort of separate laws, is it?
Okay, it's two kinds of law. All of the laws are from God. So the casuistic are from God, the apodictic are from God. It's just two kinds of laws that we find there in the law of Moses. So an example of casuistic is the Ten Commandments. But there are a lot of laws other than the Ten Commandments. And some of those are apodictic and some of those are casuistic.
Thank you.
Okay. Do we understand that? I see a lot of blank expressions. Do you understand that there are two kinds of laws? Okay, casuistic and apodictic. Casuistic say, here's the violation, here's the punishment for it. Apodictic are just general without giving a specific punishment. Okay, the Christian and the law. Jesus initiated a new way of dealing with man. And this is foretold by the prophet Jeremiah. In Jeremiah 31:31-34, it says there, I don't have this on PowerPoint, but it says, the time is coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant I made with their forefathers when I took them by the hand to lead them out of Egypt, because they broke my covenant, though I was a husband to them, declares the Lord. This is the covenant I will make with the house of Israel after that time, declares the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. I will be their God and they will be my people. No longer will a man teach his neighbor or a man his brother saying, know the Lord, because they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. For I will forgive their wickedness and remember their sins no more. Now this was fulfilled in Jesus. In fact, the longest quotation in the New Testament from the Old Testament is this passage that appears in the book of Hebrews. And the writer there shows how that Jesus fulfilled this. We have the new covenant now. In Jesus, God graciously offered to mankind his provisions, which mankind can accept or reject, but not change. Jesus, in passing the cup at the Last Supper, said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. This new covenant is the renewal of the old covenant, but transformed by Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit. Jesus said in Matthew 5:17-18, do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth disappear, not the smallest letter, not the least stroke of a pen, will by any means disappear from the law until everything is accomplished. Jesus viewed the law as completely authoritative. The law was a preparatory stage. It prepared the world for Jesus to whom it pointed. Since Jesus has come, we have a different attitude to the law. It is viewed through the New Testament. But the Old Testament is still to be taken seriously as the inspired word of God. Now, Paul's view of the law is complicated. At times, he looks at the law in very negative terms. And at other times, he sees it in very positive terms. Right now in Pauline studies, Paul's use of the law is very controversial. On the one hand, Paul tells us that the law is holy and just and good. It was given by God to be a custodian between Abraham and Christ. But on the other hand, the law was used by sin to make sin worse. Paul says that Christ is the end or the fulfillment of the law. And yet love in the Christian's life is not just pleasing God, it is fulfilling the law. The law was God's gift to his people to guide them in behavior that pleased him, and it was valid until Christ came. It is not that the law was evil, but it is now outdated. It belonged to an earlier time in God's eschatological timetable. Usually it is said that the abiding part of the law is the ethical principles that are there. The social and ceremonial laws are no longer valid. Now, I believe that that is the case, even though the law nowhere divides them between those categories. So we don't have in the law, okay, these are the ethical parts and these are the social and ceremonial parts. Which Old Testament laws are Christians bound to keep? Well, there are basically three positions. Number one, the only laws that are binding on Christians are the ones that are specifically renewed in the New Testament. This is the position of Fee and Stewart. So if it's not renewed in the New Testament, then it's not binding on Christians today. They say we should assume, in fact, that none of its stipulations, laws, are binding on us unless they are renewed in the new covenant. That is, unless the Old Testament law is somehow restated or reinforced in the New Testament, and it is no longer directly binding on God's people. The second position is that Christians are obligated to keep all the Old Testament laws unless the New Testament says they aren't. And this is the classic Calvinist position. So I think of the Scottish Presbyterians who very strictly kept the Sabbath, which was Sunday for them, but they would not do anything fun, of course, no shopping. All of that was forbidden on the Sabbath in order to keep the Old Testament law regarding the Sabbath. And then number three, Christians are obligated to keep only the laws that have not been fulfilled in Christ. And this is a middle position represented by Klein, Blomberg, and Hubbard. And this is what they say. Matthew 5:17, therefore, suggests the following hermeneutical principle for applying the Old Testament in the New Testament age. All of the Old Testament applies to Christians, but none of it applies apart from its fulfillment in Christ. Thus, our view falls in the middle ground between the views of the classic covenant theology, all the Old Testament applies except what the New Testament repeals, and in classic dispensationalism, none of the Old Testament applies except what the New Testament repeats. The former would logically lead to prohibitions against most modern farming practices and clothing fashions, while the latter would logically lead to the acceptance of sorcerers, mediums, and spiritists. For in neither case does the Old Testament say anything one way or another about these specific practices. Instead, we suggest that all of the Old Testament laws, as useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, is only as one discovers how those laws are fulfilled in Christ. So they believe that they have a midway position then between Fee and Stewart on the one hand, that none of the law has to be kept unless it's repeated in the New Testament, and the Calvinists on the other hand, that it all has to be kept unless it's repealed in the New Testament. And so here they are suggesting that all of it is relevant for us as fulfilled in Christ. And then they go on to say, how do we determine how Christ fulfills them? We suggest that where the New Testament specifically cites a particular law, the interpreter's task is eased considerably. We obey the laws of sacrifice by trusting in Christ as our once-for-all sacrifice, not by bringing sheep or goats to be slain each Sunday in church. The kosher laws were designed to set the Israelites apart from the other nations, so we obey the principle as we pursue a Christ-like lifestyle that avoids sin, even though Christ declared that all foods are clean. The symbol of baptism parallels the principle behind the law of circumcision, though the rites are not identical in all aspects. For example, Christians baptize women as well as men, and most likely the New Testament envisioned only people old enough to repent from sin rather than infants as recipients. So they look for parallels in the New Testament. Baptism parallels circumcision. Christ's sacrifice on the cross parallels the sacrifices in the temple. Our holy life, which separates us from the world, is like the kosher laws that separated the Jews from the nations around them, the Gentiles.
Can I ask something, please?
Yes.
Well, according to these writers, what they say now is whatever Jesus fulfilled in the New Testament, those are the only laws that applies in that situation.
Yes. However, it's sort of a, I would say, a subjective. It's not a one for one, you know. I'm not sure how they would apply that to everything.
Because that's more like I'm getting confused. Because the way I look at it, what about when Jesus said, I didn't come to condemn the law, but to fulfill the law.
Right.
So what the way I look at it in Jesus' words, he completed, did it. Because if it doesn't, it more like we say, oh, how on earth he said that, but he hasn't finished. So that's why I'm asking now the question, according to this man's mindset, and saying that you know, Jesus only fulfilled part of something, which is to me, it doesn't really abide to God's word and the teaching.
Okay. Well, I think the first two are pretty easy to understand. The first two positions, Fee and Stewart, say none of it applies to us unless it's renewed in the New Testament. The Calvinists say all of it applies to us unless it's done away with in the New Testament. This middle position is a little harder. How do we decide what has been fulfilled in Christ? And that is more difficult and I think more subjective. The examples, you know, that he gave here were that we don't have to offer sacrifices because Christ is our sacrifice. We don't have to keep kosher food laws or do things that separate us from the rest of the world because we are now separated from the world by living a holy life. You know, that kind of thing. That's not as clear, not as clear cut as the other two positions. So, you know, I don't have the answer to how you would classify everything. For example, do not make clothing out of two kinds of cloth. Well, did Christ fulfill that? I'm not sure. I don't really know what to do with that. So there are other things that, you know, are a little hazy when it comes to this third way of evaluating. Okay. And,
I just need to understand so that I can have a clear vision on the gospel itself, you know, because I can't half and half on the word of God and Christ, the word. No, I have to have full and clear understanding why God did this and why God he didn't do this. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
I'm just, that's why I'm asking the question, because the way the man's mind bringing in, it's more like that Jesus hasn't done it all, which is according to the scripture, he did it all, nothing else.
Okay. Well, none of these positions denies the authority of scripture. All of them are faithful in the authority of scripture. It's just a different way of interpretation. So the position I would be most comfortable with is that of Fee and Stewart, that it is the parts of the New Testament that affirm the Old Testament, or I should say it this way, it's the parts of the Old Testament that are affirmed by the New Testament that are still valid for us. So for example, Fee and Stewart say that we have the Ten Commandments. Those have been validated by Christ. Although I should point out that he nowhere validates the Sabbath. But he validates the Ten Commandments. He validates love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And he validates love your neighbor as yourself. And for Fee and Stewart, those are the only ones that are carried over into the new covenant. The Ten Commandments, love God, love your neighbor.
Thank you. Thanks, okay. Doctor.
Okay. I believe that earlier on we gave a quote from N.T. Wright, which I would want to give you here again. He says, when travelers sail across a vast ocean and finally arrive on the distant shore, they leave the ship behind and continue over land, not because the ship was no good or because their voyage had been misguided, but precisely because both ship and voyage had accomplished their purpose. During the new dry land stage of their journey, the travelers remain, and in this illustration must never forget that they remain, the people who made the voyage on the ship. So the ship is like the Old Testament. It's like the law. Now, after Christ, we are at a new stage in God's eschatological timetable. No longer is it demanded that we keep the Old Testament law in order to remain the people of God. Only those parts that Christ and the New Testament affirm are still valid for us. There is a new way of receiving atonement. It is no longer through slaughtering of bulls and goats, but it's by accepting Christ's perfect sacrifice on the cross. So now this doesn't mean, this illustration here by N.T. Wright, that we simply throw it away. You know, it's done its job, let's get rid of it. No, it is still God's word, and we accept it as God's word. We learn from it, and yet it's not his commandment to us in the same way that it was before Christ. I think that really comes across in Galatians. The law was our guardian until we came of age. And now we are no longer under the guardian. We are adults. And we are over the slave. And I think it's a good way that Paul uses there to illustrate it. Let me just say a word about the Ten Commandments. If you compare the Protestant Ten Commandments with the Catholic Ten Commandments, you'll notice that there is a difference. On the left side here, we have the Protestant version, and on the right, we have the Catholic version. In red is the difference. In the Protestant version, the second commandment is, you shall not make for yourselves an image in the form of anything in heaven above or on earth beneath or in the waters below. In the Catholic version, they skip over that and they make the second commandment, you shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. And then down at the bottom, they on the Protestant version, it is the commandment not to covet. But the Catholics split that in two, making number 9, you shall not covet your neighbor's wife. And then number 10, you shall not covet anything that belongs to your neighbor. So there are two different ways of looking at the Ten Commandments here. Now, some people have said that the reason that the Catholics took out number 2 is because they like statues. Well, I don't know. All I know is the way it actually is there. And in case you have any questions about that, this is coming up Kennan Road, going into Baguio City, and they list the Ten Commandments. In fact, most Catholic churches have the Ten Commandments written there in front of the church. And you will notice here that number 1 is, I am the Lord your God, you shall not have any other gods beside me. And number two, you shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. There is no mention of the making of statues, graven images. Okay, do you have questions or comments here before we go on? All right. Interpreting the law. And I want to give you Kay Fountain's hermeneutical steps. First of all, put yourself in the place of the writer and the first readers. To do this, you must study the historical background of the ancient Near East, particularly the period around 1500 to 1300. Number two, compare the laws in the Pentateuch with the laws of other ancient Near Eastern nations. It's very enlightening if you compare the law to, say, the law of Hammurabi and see the differences. Recognize the differences and learn from them what God was revealing to his people at that time. Apply the principle revealed in your own culture and time. And then finally, I'd like us to look at Fee and Stewart's do's and don'ts regarding the Old Testament law. Do see the Old Testament law as God's fully inspired word for you. Don't see the Old Testament law as God's direct command to you. Do see the Old Testament law as the basis for the Old Covenant and therefore for Israel's history. Don't see the Old Testament law as binding on Christians in the New Covenant except where specifically renewed. Do see God's justice, love, and high standards revealed in the Old Testament. Don't forget to see that God's mercy is made equal to the severity of the standards. Do see the Old Testament law as a paradigm, providing examples for the full range of expected behavior. Don't see the Old Testament law as complete. It is not technically comprehensive. Do remember that the essence of the law, the Ten Commandments, and the two chief laws is repeated in the prophets and renewed in the New Testament. Don't expect the Old Testament law to be cited frequently by the prophets or the New Testament. Do see the Old Testament law as a generous gift to Israel, bringing much blessing when obeyed. Don't see the Old Testament law as a grouping of arbitrary, annoying regulations limiting human freedom. All right. As an example, I would like us just to take the first commandment. And this is the way that I would interpret that, I would interpret it for a congregation today. And I don't have this on PowerPoint, so you'll just have to listen to me. Let me ask you, would you say that your country is a deeply religious country or isn't a religious country? What about your country? Is it, would you call it a religious country? Are there a lot of people who worship either our God or some kind of God?
I'm living in New Zealand. Yes, it's a religious country.
All right. It is a religious country in New Zealand.
Yeah.
Okay. Israel, what about South Korea? Is South Korea a religious country?
Yes, it is.
It is. Is it Christian, religious, or other kind of religions?
We have several religions. So, like, for example, Buddhism, especially, something like that.
Okay. Ami, what about Japan? Is Japan a religious country?
Yes, Japan is very strong Buddhist and Shintoism country. And okay. Christian population is less than 1%.
Okay. All right. Jason, what about China?
Oh, it's not a religious country.
Not a religious country.
Yeah.
Okay. And I think we know the Philippines is a religious country. And I believe that probably Samoa and Tonga would also be considered religious countries, would you say? Ani, would you call Tonga a religious country?
Well, we call ourselves a Christian country, so the majority is Christian. Well, the only other religion, that's questionable would be the Mormons, but otherwise it's, we don't have any other.
Okay. In the United States and the Western world, it is becoming supposedly, they say, less religious. Fewer people are going to church. And agnosticism, atheism are increasing. People who are called nuns, N-O-N-E-S, when they ask for what is your religious affiliation, they would put nun. That is growing. And a lot of them would consider themselves not religious. But I would argue with them, and I would say that in fact, they are deeply religious. Now you might ask, how could that be? They don't pray, they don't read the Bible, they don't acknowledge God. How can we say that they are religious? Your religion is what gives ultimate meaning to your life. True. It may not involve reading a holy book or attending a church, but everybody has in their life something without which they would consider their life meaningless. If you take this away, then the meaning of life is gone. We would call that their ultimate concern. Their ultimate concern. And this is why the Ten Commandments is not just an irrelevant relic from the distant past. The Ten Commandments deal with the core issues of our lives. The Ten Commandments are at the heart of our morality. They are God's guidelines for decent and moral behavior. They are laws, just like any other laws in the universe. If you disobey the laws, there are going to be consequences. Now, you can defy the law of gravity, but it's still the law of gravity. And if you go over that fence, like we saw in that cartoon at the beginning of this lecture here, you're going to fall and you're going to go down because it's a law that is built into the universe. The Ten Commandments were given for our good because God knew the laws of the universe as he created it, and he gave these guidelines to ensure our happiness. Now let's look at the Old Testament teaching here. The Israelites had left Egypt. this motley crew of people who came to Mount Sinai, most of them Jews, but there were others along with them that came. There Moses made his way up to the top of the mountain. The mountain was covered with clouds, and lightning and thunder came from there. And to Moses, God gave the law for the people of Israel. The heart of that law is contained in the Ten Commandments, or as the Old Testament calls them, the Ten Words. The first of these Ten Commandments is, "You shall have no other gods before me." Okay, my alarm just went off. It's time for a 10-minute break. So let's take a break and we'll come back in 10 minutes. All right. In the ancient world, first of all, let me put in my earphones. In the ancient world, the world was filled with gods. Man in those days believed that everything that existed had its god. The sun, the moon, the sea, the sky, fire, wind, rivers, mountains, wood, all of these things, they thought, had their god. So the world was filled with gods. Then later, nations tended to adopt a god. And then if you went to another nation, you would be obligated to worship that god. So if a princess of one country were to marry the king of another country, she would take her gods with her, and they would be worshiped in the new country. That happened under King Solomon, and it happened with Ahab and Jezebel. With Israel entering into the land of Canaan, where the gods Moloch and Mammon and the Baals were worshiped, they had to be clear on this one point. They would worship only the Lord as their God. There could be no compromise on this point. The Lord demands exclusive worship. And it must be that way because the Lord is God over all so-called gods and lords. There is only one God who is the creator of heaven and earth. To worship any other God is not only to reject God, but it is to fly in the face of truth. So God begins the Ten Commandments with, "You shall have no other gods before me." Now, let's think of the cities where we live, the towns. People who consider themselves secular, they worship no gods. And yet, I would say that they are very religious. The theologian Paul Tillich defines religion as a state of being grasped by an ultimate concern. These are the issues in life. Those concerns and goals to which we have committed ourselves and which give meaning to the rest of life. These things compromise or comprise our religion. This means that people who never go through the door of a church, never bow a knee in prayer, never give credence to any church's doctrine, who consider themselves totally secularized, are actually extremely religious people. They are just bowing to different gods. Their ultimate concerns are their gods. Are you following me so far? Do you see what we're saying? That these people, like, you know, the people in China who say there is no God, they are actually religious people. And if you find out what it is that gives meaning to their life, that is their God. you know, God made man to be a worshiping being. He has to give allegiance to someone or something. So that thing to which he gives allegiance is his God. Now, in light of that, let us look at that first commandment again. You shall have no other gods before me. This isn't limited to idols and altars and incense and sacrifices. It rather challenges every man and woman to evaluate their commitments. And when they do, they will discover their gods. And if their gods are not the Lord, excuse me, then they are breaking the first of the Ten Commandments. But, you know, some people say, well, you know, hey, we're Christians. We go to church every Sunday, or we attend the youth group, we sing in the worship team, and we serve on church committees. Why are you saying this to us? Because you can consider yourself outwardly to be a very religious person when your ultimate concern lies elsewhere. How many Christians today come to church, you know, they enjoy it, they believe what the preacher says, they are good people, they are interested in church, it's one of their favorite hobbies, but God and Jesus Christ are not really the things that give meaning and purpose to their lives. Their, you know, quote, religion is an appendix, it's an add-on. It's an ornament to their lives. The really important things in their lives lie elsewhere. Formally, they worship God, but in reality, they serve other gods. They too break the first commandment. You shall have no other gods before me, because God is a jealous God and he demands our ultimate loyalty. So what are the gods of your nation? Think of your city. What are their real gods? Experiences, pleasures, things, college education, money in the bank, cars, houses.
What's
that? What was that, Johnny?
Sports.
Oh, sports. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, I think there are parts of the United States where their major religion is college basketball. They get more excited about that than they do about God. Yeah. All of these things which capture our hearts, which give meaning and purpose to our lives, that really excite us, these things can become our gods. So let's not think that this commandment, given so many thousands of years ago, is simply something irrelevant for us today. It's very much relevant. So God says, you shall have no other gods before me. I am your God and I will have no rivals. Because God is a jealous God. And when we go and we worship other things, we are committing spiritual adultery. And I would submit to you that the New Testament gives us the same message. Look at Jesus demands for discipleship. What does he say? He says, except you hate your father and mother and wife and children and yourself, you cannot be my disciple. Unless Jesus Christ is our first love, then we cannot be his disciple. So we have basically this same thought coming back in the New Testament as well as the old. Now, of course, we know that Jesus was using hyperbole there when he said hate. And as Matthew tells us, it's talking about Christ or our having a greater love for Christ than anything else. So, you know, Dickie is my wife and I love her, and she has no rival in my life. That doesn't mean I have to hate every woman that I see, but it means that she has to be my first love in terms of that kind of relationship. And it's the same way with our relationship with God. We don't hate other people. We don't hate things. You know, we don't hate cars because that could become a god to us. But we love Jesus Christ so much that these other things are not rivals. These other things don't compete with him, because he has first place in our lives. Anyway, if I take this and I interpret this commandment, it's going to be more than simply looking at the historical background and that kind of thing. We have to bring it to today. Knowing the historical background, knowing those kinds of things are extremely important. We have to do that. Knowing the cultural background. But we have to bring it to today. And I think that if you've heard me, you can see that I think that it's very relevant for our lives today. Okay. Do you have questions or comments here? How we would deal with a commandment in the Old Testament? You know, think about you shall not commit adultery. I mean, that's very clear cut. But Jesus tells us that there is more than simply getting in bed with your neighbor's wife. Lust in your heart is committing adultery. What about coveting? Wanting something that your neighbor has to the point that you would even be willing to do anything to get it. Coveting, that desire for things that don't belong to you. Murder, you know, what did Jesus say about murder? Anger with your brother is murder. And so, for Christians, it's internalized. It's not simply outward actions. It's the state of the heart. So the commands of the Old Testament are extremely relevant in our lives today. Now, some of them seemingly are not. The King James of Deuteronomy 22 says that a woman shall not wear clothing that pertaineth to a man. And I know from that, it's interpreted that a woman should not wear the same kind of clothes that men wear. So back during the 1970s, you know, when pantsuits came in style for women, it was a big controversy. Can women wear pantsuits? Oh, no, no, no. That's men's clothes. It's not a skirt, it's pants. Well, you know, Jesus wore more like a skirt. It was a robe. Jesus didn't wear pants. So if we're going to go back to the Bible, then, you know, our perception of that is going to be a little different. We're interpreting in terms of Western society. In the islands, they have lava lavas. And I have not worn a lava lava. Dickie keeps wanting me to wear a lava lava, but I don't think it's going to happen. Or in Myanmar, they have longis, same kind of thing, you know, except the longis go down to your ankles. But that's not the image that a man from the West wants to have, you know? So I'm probably not going to wear one. Although if I were going to be a missionary in Myanmar, I probably wouldn't want to wear a longi. So that there would be no barrier between me and the people there. Although styles are changing there very quickly. Yeah. Okay, give me some input. What do you think about application of the commandments to our lives today? Interpreting the true meaning of the commandments and applying them to our lives. Any feedback? What do you think?
What I find is now we're living in more serious times, because before, you know, it's outward show. And when you show it outwardly, then it's sin. But now it's God who's looking at us inside, how we think and how we act in our heart towards our brother and sister is more difficult. And I believe that's why God sent his Holy Spirit to help us. And at the same time, Jesus said in John chapter 15 to continue to abide in him every single day, because if we don't abide in him and don't have the consciousness and the intention of abiding in him, consciousness to know that we serve a God in every action, every thinking, everything that we do, it will affect us. And so I believe it is more difficult now. That's why we more need more of God through the power of the Holy Spirit to help us.
Okay, good thought, Joni. I appreciate that. And remember something that Fee and Stewart said, and that is that Christ's teaching are not commands, not like the law of Moses. They're not commands for us to keep, but they are a description of the Christian life. So I think that's an interesting way of looking at it. Other comments? Any feedback?
I think that, like what he said, I think the interpretation is the crucial parts of the Bible itself and understanding. And unless I think that's the most, this is the most crucial things, as we now find out in the humanetics topics. Unless we have an understanding about the history, especially the background of the thing, the time, then we're never gonna make any suitable things. We are more like abusing God's word in a sense. Mm-hmm. So that's why I thank you, Dr. Fodi, for bringing up all these things. To me now, unless I have a clear understanding, you know, like Johnny said, with the help of the Holy Spirit, praying God that please, you know, help us clarify his mighty word. And then we never know the understanding, or otherwise, like Fee and Stewart say, it's a teaching. It's not a command thing, you know? Mm-hmm. When Jesus came to fulfill that thing, he didn't command things. He more like teaching how to live. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and how to, you know, abide God's, the Father's law. Mm-hmm. But to me, I just say thank you, Doctor. Thank you.
Well, yeah. It is important to know that. Realize that many of your fellow pastors do not know that. They do not know the history. They are not familiar with that, and they don't know how to find out. And so they are going to be operating at a different level from the rest of you who are here. And we need to take that into account when we, you know, we deal with other people and other pastors and realize where they're coming from. Yeah.
Professor, can we say that we should distinguish the spirit and the form of the law, and or say the spirit of the law is unchangeable, but the forms are unchangeable according to different occasions or something like that?
Yeah, I think that's a good way of looking at it. For example, let's go back to the sowing different kinds of seed in the field. There must have been a reason for that. And if we can discover the reason for that, then we can find the principle that applies universally. I think it was more than just God saying, well, I just don't want you to do this. I mean, there must have been some reason for that. And I think discovering the principle for that is important. And then we can apply it to our lives today. Yeah.
Yeah. So I think this is very, very important and very critical in our lives, especially as pastors. What I find is not only people, but leaders in the church, they tend to mix up the idea of law and grace. They don't really understand it. And it seeps through into our view of the gospel and what Jesus teaches. And we tend to be religious and legalistic about it, in the sense that when we break it, they tend to feel really bad and when they don't abide in it. But for me, what God has been teaching me through the years is that, you know, it's about relationship with me. Try and keep on trying to grow closer to you, because our relationship with God is progressive, and He sanctifies us progressively throughout. And I believe this is an area that we as leaders need to teach it to the church, and also to the pastors. And some of us are teaching in our Bible schools. Maybe we need to emphasize this also.
Yes, I think what you say is extremely important. You know, I grew up in, at least as I interpreted as a child, a quite legalistic environment. It might have been my fault for my interpretation of it, but, you know, being a Christian meant keeping all the rules. Breaking a rule meant you weren't a Christian anymore. And when I, in college, my first year at Southern California College, our Assemblies of God College, I transferred in as a junior, took a course from Dr. Gordon Fee, my life was transformed. It was transformed when I discovered grace. It changes everything. It changes everything. Now, when you go from earning your salvation or trying to make God love you by keeping all the rules to living a life of love for God, it's completely different. It makes your life completely different. And that is what I had to learn. And it's so easy to look at it as a legalistic thing. I got to keep the rules. If I break a rule, God won't like me anymore. He won't love me anymore. Well, He will love you. He'll be disappointed if you sin, but He'll still love you, just as I love my kids when they mess up. Not that we are soft on what it means to live a Christian life, not at all. I think, you know, some of you pointed out that it's more radical. The law is more radical under Christ than it is under Moses, because Christ goes to the heart. And but the Holy Spirit gives us the power to live a life pleasing to God. So, I think you all are sharing some really good ideas here. I really appreciate it. Okay, if there are no more questions or comments, we ought to go on to the next genre. And that is prophecy. All right. We should first of all note that what we usually call prophecy and what the Jewish people called prophecy are different. Here is the structure in the English Bible. We have law, and then we have history, and we have poetry. We have the major prophets and the minor prophets. So in our English Bibles, and I'm quite certain that would be in your native language Bibles, the same way. For the Jews, there were three categories: the law, the prophets, and the writings. The law, or the Torah, was the first five books of the Bible, the Pentateuch. The prophets fall into two categories: the former prophets and the latter prophets. So Joshua, Judges, Samuel, and Kings are all considered prophets. And then the latter prophets are Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and the Book of the 12, which we would call the minor prophets. And then the writings, we have the poetic books, which is Psalms, Job, and Proverbs, the five scrolls, which is Ruth, Song of Solomon, Ecclesiastes, and Lamentations, and the historical books, Daniel, Ezra, Nehemiah, and Chronicles. Note that Daniel is considered a historical book rather than a book of prophecy. So we have the former prophets and the latter prophets in the Hebrew Old Testament. So most of the last half of the Hebrew scriptures is prophecy. In fact, the latter prophets here form a large portion of the Old Testament. The prophecies in these books were primarily verbal messages delivered by the prophet to their audiences. The messages were written down and later were compiled by others and put into books that bear the name of the prophet. As we look at the individual books themselves, we see that the oracles in them are addressed to a variety of audiences and were given at various times. The arrangement of the oracles are not necessarily in chronological order, you know, from first to last, time-wise. For example, the book of Jeremiah seems almost random in the order in which the things happen. So we'll have something that happened late, and then later we'll have something that happened early. The word prophet comes from the Greek word prophetes, which can mean speak for or speak before. The Hebrew word for prophet is the word navi, which means a called one, one whom God has called. So a prophet is one who is called by God and speaks for God. Now, prophets are also called seers, but there seems to be no difference in function. The term prophet and seer are used synonymously in the Old Testament. The writing prophets of the Old Testament spanned the 8th to the 5th centuries BC, Amos probably being the first, and Malachi the last. Now, there were two functions of prophets in the Old Testament. First of all, to speak to the contemporary situation, and we call this forthtelling. Can you read that word forthtelling very easily there? It sort of blends into the background, I think. Is it legible?
Right. Yeah.
Okay. The messages were written down, and it was speaking to their contemporary situation. So these were preachers. Basically, what that means is these were preachers preaching to people of their time. Secondly, it was to predict the future only as a means to speak to the contemporary situation. Now, this speaking of the future is called foretelling. So forthtelling, speaking to the present situation, and foretelling, speaking of the future. Now, when many people think of prophecy, it's foretelling that they think of. But most prophecy has nothing to do with telling the future. In fact, according to Fee and Stewart, less than 2% of the Old Testament prophecy is messianic. Less than 5% describes the New Covenant age. And less than 1% concerns events yet to come in our time. Hubbard, Bush, and Lesore define prophecy as God's message in the present in the light of the ongoing redemptive mission. And they also say, since God's redeeming purpose culminates in Jesus Christ, all prophecy somehow must point to Christ. In that sense, Christ fulfills prophecy, or rather, prophecy is fulfilled in him. While this may not be what is commonly understood by fulfillment of prophecy, it is the definition properly derived from the biblical evidence. Now, some prophecies are unconditional, such as God's blessing of the world through Abraham, the heir to sit on David's throne, the new covenant, the new heavens, and the new earth. These things are going to be done by God, and it doesn't depend on what man does. They are unconditional. But some of God's promises are conditional. In fact, a majority of the Old Testament prophecies are conditional. The prophecies of Leviticus 26, 34 to 30 to 45 are an example. Almost every paragraph there begins with the word if. If the people act in this way, then God will do this. The same is true of the promises of blessings and curses in Deuteronomy 28 to 32. Most of the time, the prophet tells what will happen, or when they tell what will happen, it depends on how the people respond to the message of the prophet. And a good example of that is Jonah. His message was 40 more days and Nineveh will be overthrown. But Jonah knew that if the people repent, God will relent. And that's why Jonah went toward Tarshish. He didn't want the people of Nineveh to repent. He wanted them to be destroyed. The Old Testament prophets were covenant enforcement officers. They reminded the people of the covenant demands and warned them when they broke them. According to Duval and Hayes, The prophets function as prosecuting attorneys. They accuse the people of sin and warn them of the consequences of their sin. They make three basic points. Number one, you have broken the covenant. You had better repent. Number two, no repentance, the judgment. And number three, yet there is hope beyond the judgment for a glorious future restoration. The prophets do not necessarily have a video-like view of the future. God revealed sufficient information to bring correction in the present and to give hope for the future. At times, the prophet would be given visions of events, that would happen in the immediate future, and others that would happen in the far future. The prophet doesn't necessarily distinguish between them. And we call that prophetic foreshortening or eschatological foreshortening. It's been likened to seeing a number of mountain ranges in the distance. And here is a picture that I took in front of my house there in Baguio. From a distance, they look like they're all together. But the closer that you get, you realize that those mountains are far apart. And that's the way it is with prophetic foreshortening. From our view, from the prophet's view, there are all these events and it seems like they happen right together. But in reality, they are far apart. So some of those events that we see in the prophets happened immediately. Others maybe haven't even happened yet. And so that is a characteristic of prophecy. They see events in the future, but they're often seen as very close together when they're really not. Let me just pause and ask if you have any questions or comments. Okay.
Can you repeat again the difference between fourth theory and the fourth theory?
Yes. Fourth telling. F-O-R-T-H, telling, is giving a message for the present. It is giving forth a message. And it's a message that is, it pertains to the people that the prophet is speaking to. Okay? Foretelling is telling the future. Okay, so foretelling has to do with the present and foretelling has to do with the future. I would say probably a majority of Christians, when they think of prophecy, they think of foretelling. So if you say in church, I'm going to give a series on prophecy, well, what do they think? They think it's going to be on eschatology. It's going to be on the second coming of Christ. It's going to be on the tribulation and the millennium. But the majority of prophecy is forthtelling, not foretelling. So the real emphasis of prophecy is preaching to people there, calling for repentance. It's not simply telling about what's going to happen in the future. That's not normally the focus. Okay. I'm going to go over some basic types of prophecy. Let me just tell you right up front here, this is not going to be on the final. And this kind of thing, even though hermeneutics books think this is important, to me, I don't think it's that important. So I'm not going to be asking about this on the final exam, okay? But just to give you basic types of prophecy, and this is from Klein, Blomberg, and Hubbard, there's a prophecy of disaster. The prophesied disaster could be either immediate or in the distant future, or it could be for an individual or a nation. For example, Isaiah 30:15-17. This is what the Sovereign Lord, the Holy One of Israel, says. In repentance and rest is your salvation. In quietness and trust is your strength. Hey, isn't that a nice verse? I mean, great promises. In repentance and rest is your salvation. In quietness and trust is your strength. But then look at the next line. But you would have none of it. You said, no, we will flee on horses. Therefore, you will flee. You said, we will ride off on swift horses. Therefore, your pursuers will be swift. A thousand will flee at the threat of one. At the threat of five, you will all flee away till you are left like a flagstaff on a mountain, like a banner on a hill. So a prophecy of disaster. A prophecy of salvation, Jeremiah 28:2-4. This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. I will break the yoke of the king of Babylon. Within 2 years, I will bring back to this place all the articles of the Lord's house that Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, removed from here and took to Babylon. I will also bring back to this place Jehoiachin, son of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, and all the other exiles from Judah who went to Babylon, declares the Lord, for I will break the yoke of the king of Babylon. A woe speech. And this is a prophecy of disaster, but the thing that distinguishes it is that it begins with the interjection, woe. Malachi 2:1-5. Woe to those who plan iniquity, to those who plot evil on their beds. At morning's light, they carry it out because it is in their power to do it. They covet fields and seize them, and houses and take them. They defraud people of their homes. They rob them of their inheritance. Therefore, the Lord says, I am planning disaster against this people from which you cannot save yourselves. You will no longer walk proudly, for it will be a time of calamity. In that day, people will ridicule you. They will taunt you with this mournful song. We are utterly ruined. My people's possession is divided up. He takes it from me. He assigns our field to traitors. Therefore, you will have no one in the assembly of the Lord to divide the land by lot. The prophetic dirge. And a dirge is a funeral lament. And here it is recited over Israel as if she is a corpse awaiting burial. Amos 5:1-3. Hear this word, Israel. This lament I take up concerning you. Fallen is virgin Israel, never to rise again. Deserted in her own land, with no one to lift her up. This is what the Sovereign Lord says to Israel. Your city that marches out 1,000 strong will only have 100 left. Your town that marches out 100 strong will have only 10 left. There's a prophetic hymn. Let me just mention this because our time is gone. And there's an example. The prophetic liturgy and the prophetic disputation, much like the diatribe. And we have an example in Amos 3. And characteristics of prophetic disputation, God himself speaks rather than the prophet. The speaker doesn't announce a new revelation, and rhetorical questions are used. And then we have the prophetic lawsuit with some examples here. Prophetic vision report and prophetic narratives. Okay, we will stop there. Like I said, I'm not going to require you to know those 10 different items there, the different kinds of prophecies. To me personally, it is not helpful. So I'm not going to ask you to know those. All right. Do you have any final question or comment before we go?
I have a question.
Yes. As
for the eschatological foretelling.
Mm-hmm.
So my question is, did they distinguish prophecies eschatological as a prophecy?
You're breaking up and it's hard to understand. Say it again, please.
Okay. My question is, how did Israelites know the prophecy was eschatological instead of just a distant prophecy?
I'm not sure how you distinguish between eschatological and distant. My first way of answering that would be they didn't know. The prophet himself didn't know. They knew that what the prophet said was going to come true, and maybe they assumed that all of it was going to happen immediately, but we know that not all of it was. Now, there are times when the prophet does realize that it's going to be a long time before this part of the prophecy comes to pass, but usually that's not the case. I don't know, does that help, Jason?
Yes, of course.
Okay. Well, the Lord bless you, and we will see you in a couple of days. We'll see you on Friday morning. God bless you.
Safe.
Thank you.
God bless everybody.
Thank you. God bless you.